Thank you for choosing to listen to this message by our pastor, Brother Mike Beachy. Let us join now with the saints of God with open hearts and minds into a service already in progress. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
All right, you can be seated if you like. Amen. I would say it's good to see everybody here this morning. And I mean, it counts as a real privilege and honor to be in church. Amen. We're blessed folks. Blessed folks. You hear stories from all over the world, the terrible things people go through. Some folks have to go to church under a tree. Some folks don't even have a tree to go to church under. I remember seeing a picture of folks sitting with umbrellas. They call it umbrella church. And it wasn't raining, but it was just so hot. It was out in the open, had to get out away from where the authorities couldn't see them, and they were all sitting under umbrellas because it was just so hot. Try to keep the sun off. So we're blessed, not only of having a nice little building, but we're blessed to be partakers of the truth and to believe we're in God's will. How many believes you're in God's will this morning?
Amen.
Amen. All right, praise God. Does anybody have a testimony this morning? All right, well, Brother Jonathan, how about coming up maybe sing one for us and tell us what the Lord's been doing there around High Point and been doing for you and the family. You know, the Brother Smith was here the other evening, kind of reminded me of Brother Jonathan a little bit. I don't know if y'all thought about that, but I thought about Brother Jonathan. I don't know if Brother Jonathan's met Dale Smith. It was a minister came and spoke the other evening. Made me think of Brother Jonathan a whole lot there. Why don't you come on up, Brother Jonathan, and maybe say a word to him, sing us a song. I mean, glad to see Brother Jonathan and his family here. Let's give him a good old hand.
Praise the Lord. It's wonderful to be here and be a part of what God is doing. Just thankful to the Lord for His grace and His mercy toward us. And thankful that He continues to lead us and to guide us. I guess in my life, in the past, I don't know, this past year and past several years, the Lord's just really been, He's been showing Himself to me, revealing Himself to me. You know, I've said this, and you know, I was asked to testify, and so sometimes it's hard for a preacher to testify and not preach, but I'm going to try to, I know the difference, so I'm going to try to abide in what I was asked to do. I believe a man that follows the leading of the Lord, I believe he knows the difference, and he knows how, because the Bible says the prophecy is subject to the prophet, and just because a man likes to preach don't mean he has to every time. So, you know, I made a statement several times. Y'all probably heard it before, but I said, you know, it seems like that the Lord in these latter times is screaming at us. And I used the illustration that, you know, you might be out in your yard doing yard work or something. You see your children out there and they start getting a little close to the road, and you might tell them to, hey, come back. And you may not be hollering at them. You might just be talking to them, you know, hey, don't get too close to the road, you know. And before you know it, they might have a toy or a puppy or something to go out in the road, and here goes the child right headlong into the road. And you see a vehicle coming, you're not going to say, hey, get out of the road. You're going to scream with everything you got because you want them to get their attention. And I believe with all my heart, in the past few years, in this latter times, God is screaming at us with all of He's got, because He's trying to get us to wake up. You know, the Bible says that, and it's speaking of the last times, and it says, and all were asleep. It's talking about the bridegroom and coming, and all of the virgins were asleep. It didn't say that some of them wasn't asleep. It said that all of them were asleep. That includes all. That includes all. And the bridegroom's calling out, behold, the bridegroom cometh. And He's screaming at us for it to get our attention. And in the past few years, you know, and I said this the other week in ministering, I said I would be somewhat of a foolish man to sit and think that 3 years ago, just about 3 years ago, almost to the date, that we was in a car accident that could have took the lives of all of my children. Could have took mine too. But more so theirs than mine, the way the accident took place. should have been a lot more damage that happened to him than what did. But by the mercies of God, and because he loves us, and because of praying people. You know, this past year, I guess some people, when I say things to them testifying, they say, well, you sure had a rough year. I said, well, God's been helping us. You know, it's hard. And my brother's here and he can testify, and many of you can. Brother Mike has been through it. It's hard to see a parent who's always been strong and healthy dwindling away to nothing and have to be helped. And it's hard to see them as their life just goes away. And it's hard, even more so, that just a few weeks later, the other one's gone. And then I guess, you know, and I said this not long ago. I said, there was a time I didn't know what it was like to experience those things. And I didn't know, you know, I hear people going through things and I could pray, but now I can pray a little different because I've experienced it. I've heard about people losing everything they own, but I never experienced it until now. I've experienced it. But I've also experienced watching a God who is so loving and gracious to move upon people's hearts. And it's like, you know, right now I'm looking for a home. And somebody said, well, you should have found one by now. Well, I could have found one by now, but I'm picky. I want to be in a certain area because I want to stay close to my church home. But it looks like I may have to move away a little bit. And it ain't so bad, but I'm trying to consider my wife. Children, they have to be there at the church every day. And so I'm trying to consider them. But I'm praying. I know the Lord's got a place, and he's going to show us pretty soon where something's at. And I just love God, and I thank him. I thank him. In North Carolina, we're, as far as the work there, we're trying to make a little bit of noise. We hadn't done a lot, but Brother Rob is getting cranked up in the printing and stuff, and he's about to come out with some more publications of some different tracks. He's printing some of the ones that we had already that's about to go out of stock, and he's getting some of those stocked back up, and then he's starting to he's trying to put some others that the Lord had given him that he's written, some writings that he turned into tracks. And he's trying to get them in writing or in track form and in public and print. He's going to publication print. He's going to make a little book, another little booklet. We have one. He's going to make another little booklet. And what it's going to be is a compilation of several little writings of like tracks. And it's going to be like a booklet of several different tracks. And then he's going to also have some of those writings in the booklet available for separate distribution as well. But pray for us. Pray the Lord will lead and guide and will help us. And we're looking, hopefully, by the help of the Lord, if it's his will, to maybe build a sanctuary in the next coming year or at least get one started. We'd like to at least get one started and maybe build a little bit bigger of a building over there for just the sanctuary. And he's thinking about doing it and just and doing it like a quick one to where we don't have to put in no bathrooms. We'll prepare for that, but we won't put in no bathrooms immediately. We'll use the ones that's in the fellowship hall there and just have a breezeway going back and forth. And that's what he's looking into, all the legalities and how to do that. So just pray for us and pray that God will help us, that as you are here in Georgia making a noise for the Lord and trying to stand for the gospel, that we, as your brothers and sisters, can stand for the same gospel there in North Carolina. Pray for us as we endeavor to do something for God, and as we pray for y'all. And as I requested earlier about Brother David, it's just something that's come up. And he was working at the church on one Saturday, a couple Saturdays ago, working at the church out there. We had a cleanup day, and some of them was working out there. he was dragging brush and everything, and Monday he went into the hospital and they said he had pneumonia and some other complications, and he got better and he got worse and he got better and he got worse, and now they did some other things, and they're saying that he's, from what I understand from the reports that I got last, is that he has a prostate cancer, and he also has his gut going into his bones, and he has the first stages of bone cancer, and his prostate cancer is pretty advanced, but when you get information through people, it's hard to get clear information, because when people are experiencing things, they don't really sometimes take heed, or they don't really listen to everything that's being said. And so the information you get is not identical to what they got. So, but pray for him. His testimony is that the Lord come to him on three different occasions and told him that he wasn't through with him. And the doctors are saying he has less than 6 weeks to live. But he said that the Lord come to him and said he wasn't through with him. So praise God. Brother Rob said he prayed for him Friday. He felt the virtue of the Lord come into the room and come through. He said he likes to feel that virtue of the Lord leave his body. And when he did, he said that whether it be for Brother David's peace as to a contact, and he said he was ready if that's what the Lord wanted to do. But he also said that the man could walk out of there healed. That was what he felt in his spirit. And so we're just trusting the Lord. The doctors are still wanting to do what they want to do. They want to send you to hospice care or hospice house. So fine, we'll just trust the Lord and see the way it goes. He did say sing a song. I don't know, here lately I don't do a lot of singing by myself. But I'm gonna try one. I know they know it. Whisper a prayer that I can get through it. We practiced this with Brother Pete and his family, and wanted me to help sing it. So we had been dabbling with this song over the years, me and Brother Pete, when we get around each other, and he's playing. And we'll get to singing these Brother George's songs, and this is one that we've sang off and on. And it's got a whole different meaning to it now to me than it ever has. And I'm going to try to hold it together while I sing it. And I think it'll bless some of you too. Don't listen to the singing. Listen to the words. And I don't know what key. It's Heavenly Treasures. I think they did it in. It was either G or C, but I'm not sure.
In this world here below, with its heartaches and sorrows, there's so many treasures that one can bestow. But we fail here to see our greatest possession, until our dear loved ones have fallen to sleep. And just over the mountain, beyond the great valley, where heavenly treasures are waiting for me. Well, I'm longing to go. There's a little trail winding just upward to glory, where I'm yearning to be. And I remember so well the days of my childhood with Mama and Daddy, whom I love so dear. Well, then life was so grand. together. Oh, but it just ain't the same since Mother's not here. And just over the mountain beyond the great valley, where heavenly treasures are waiting for me. And I'm longing to go. There's a little trail winding upward to glory, where I'm yearning to be. The lights of my home, they shine over the hilltop, where my mama and daddy are waiting for me. And this little trail leads to my home up in heaven. Oh, where the face of my Savior someday I shall see. Oh, just over the mountain beyond the rim, where heavenly treasures are waiting for me. And I'm longing to go. For there's a little trail winding just upward to glory, where I'm yearning. Why don't y'all stand with me and sing that chorus again, can you? Oh, just over the mountain beyond the great valley,
sing. It says, I got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. And folks, it just keeps getting sweeter and sweeter. Sweeter and sweeter. No, we don't like to lose our loved ones. We don't like to see them cross over, but it just makes heaven a lot sweeter. And it makes just a whole lot closer to us. A whole lot closer to us. I tell you what, you know, the old song says, Rusty Goodman wrote a song, and I wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. And he got that song from standing at the bedside of a preacher who was on his dying bed. And he said, do you have any regrets of anything you ever done? And he said, the man looked at him and said, I wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. Wouldn't take nothing for it, because heavens just keep getting sweeter, and I can see the lights. I can see the lights. And that's when he wrote that song, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. I got to make it to heaven somehow. The devil may come and trick us, but we just got to stand on the things of God. We got to stand on the truth. I love you. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen. Appreciate Brother Jonathan. Amen. I always appreciate Brother Jonathan them coming down and sharing their enthusiasm for the Lord with us. Amen. You can be seated if you like. Maybe Brother Eddie, maybe you and Sister Sheila got a song y'all can sing? While they're getting ready, Brother Kenny and some of the folks went over to the hospital last night, and from what I understand, they had a real good service. I wonder if maybe Joel would just stand up right where you're at and just kind of address the congregation and tell us what you saw last night, what you experienced in the service. Would you do that, Brother John? Joel?
I had a wonderful service last night. The presence of God moved strong last night. You just feel it moving over the crowd. You know, like we said before, those people, they live in darkness. You know, the devil just, he controls that room. When you go in there, you feel the presence of God coming with you. Like we said before, this creates a bubble where, well, they can come in and have peace. You know, for a few moments, they can have it in their right mind, you know. And I mean, I'll say again, if you ain't never went, you need to go. It is encouraging to you. We were singing that, what a friend we have in Jesus. And the intent that let us in, just to see him, you thought he had been a big, tough, big head, tattoos and stuff. I look over behind the crowd, and he's over there, wiping his eyes and crying, And that thing's amazing. If you think you're ministering to the patient, but you'll see also that you'll see the attendants getting involved. You know, and that's the thing. We have a great gift in getting our brother George and Brother Mike when he speaks to us. And, we got to share that gift. You know, the Lord showed me one day, I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? He said, let your light shine. You know what I mean? And that's what we have to do. We go up there, and it's a dark, dark place. You know, the Lord moved on you. The presence of God just moved so sweet. I mean, it was almost palpable. You know, it was very good. I mean, the Lord moved. And keep praying for those folks. They need it. And keep praying for the king and the people that go up there. Says, like I said, walk into a cave, and you're the only light. You know, I'm telling you, it's an amazing experience. It'll encourage you. Just keep us in your prayers, because, can't try to go up there, you feel the Satan wants to fight and wants to interfere, but the presence of God just kind of comes and just smothers him out, The Lord's good. He keeps on moving, but just keep us in your prayers.
Amen. Maybe one more. Stephanie, how about stand up and kind of give us an idea of what you saw and experienced? Stephanie, I thought Stephanie went.
Samantha.
Okay, Samantha. How about stand up and give us a little testimony, Samantha?
I always love to go. Like Joel said, it's a real blessing to all of us. And just like you said, keep them in prayer because they need it, and give
me your prayers. Amen. I tell you, Brother Keeney's really got a burden for those folks up there. And you know what? It's doing some good. It's doing some good. You never know. As we've said before, you never know who's receiving what down into their hearts. Some may come and, hear it and go away, and it never fazes them. But there's others that... the Word of God goes down and finds a lodging place. How many know that in your heart, one day, the Word of God found a lodging place? Ain't you glad? Ain't you glad somebody came and told you about Jesus? Amen. And we're here to testify today that we're so glad. And I'm sure those folks, some of them, the Word of God will find a lodging place in their heart. And that's what changes their lives. That's what will set them free. Amen. All right, let's give Brother Eddie and him a good old hand. Make them welcome.
Once again, I face Satan this morning, and I battled him all the day long. But in my weakness, God sent reinforcement. At sundown, I sang victory song, and the sun's coming up,
How many's ever faced Satan in the morning? Amen. You know, you can get up and look in the mirror to shave or comb your hair. You better watch out. You're facing the enemy. You can overcome that old character in the mirror. You got the victory. Amen. All right. Brother Roger, how about send that basket down? Let's take just a minute or two and give you an opportunity to share with the Lord and to bid God speed to the work of God. And remember the different projects going on. Remember the Moldova project. We've got more pictures coming, Brother Roger, I think. They're sending them. I think they're having a little problem. Some of the children might have been off and gone, and so they're trying to get them all collected, but they should be sending some more pictures pretty soon. And I know there's different ones have asked for them that haven't gotten them yet. So, but pray for the folks in Moldova. Pray for Brother Florine. They've got a real job ahead of them. And we can just do our little part, keep our little end of it up, and the different ones can keep their little end of it up. It'll be a big help to him. All right, praise the Lord. I know we come to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord this morning. Brother Kenny, won't you come up maybe lead us in a song or two? Would you do that this morning? And we'll just take a few minutes to worship the Lord while you're giving and sharing. And how many came anticipating God's word? Something good from God this morning. Yeah. Amen. We come anticipating and expecting something real good from the Lord. And I believe he's here to bless us this morning. Brother Kenny.
Let's stand together and we'll sing a couple songs together. Praise the Lord. Do appreciate all your prayers, and I know that there's been some people that's been fasting for several days. And so appreciative to know that people are concerned about lost souls. And so appreciative that you've kept us in your prayers and ask God's blessings and keep them people in your prayers. Keep them in your prayers. Did have several people. Brother Christian, Sister Tammy went with us last night, and Sister Samantha and Brother Joel, Brother Joshua Shephart, Sister Beverly, and of course, Shell. Usually, if you've seen me, you've seen her, so that's the way it's supposed to be, ain't it? That's the way it's supposed to be. And Brother Christian was able to give his testimony how the Lord changed his mind, changed his heart. And Christian, I want you to say a little something for the Lord and how what you thought about the service last night. You stood right there, didn't you?
I really enjoyed it. I wasn't totally sure we was going to be able to go until about last minute. We went up there, and there's this one lady, I don't remember her name, but she was real messed up in her thoughts, and she kept on interrupting the service, and she was tearing tracks up that we gave her, just ripping up the tracks, and she kept making comments interrupting the service. And at first, it really frustrated me, you know. What was wrong with her? You know, it really bothered me, you know. And I was sitting there thinking about it, and I was like, you know, there was a time not very long ago I was just like that. And I tore up things that were a lot worse than tracks. I tore up Bibles, you know. So I look at somebody like that and I really pity her. And I just got to praying in my mind. I said, well, what is that lady going to think? Is that going to kill her and destroy her? She's not going to know her family. She was raised, from what I can gather, as a Roman Catholic church. That's done a lot of good for her. No, just keep that lady in prayer because she really needs it. Amen.
That's the one thing I've observed through the, I guess, about 12 years that we've been going up there, dealing with young people at first, and then, of course, the West unit there, which is the adults. The religion never does much good for anybody. Religion never really does any good for anybody, whether it's Bible-based or Koran-based or whatever-based it is. But I found out that the Holy Ghost can change you, and that Christianity is real. If you've ever experienced it, you can talk about it, you can read about it, but until you truly experience Christ as an experience, a personal relationship, then you've really not known God. You've not known salvation. So it's good that we should exercise our spiritual senses. Praise God. Let's sing this song, 101, He Hideth My Soul. Aren't you glad to be in Christ this morning? Praise God.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where
Glad the Lord got you covered this morning. Amen. You know, a good friend covers you back. You know, sometimes when you can't see what's going on and maybe the enemy's approaching from the rear, you know your friend has got your back. I'm glad Jesus not only has our back, but he has our heart. He has our soul. He's got us covered. Let's give the Lord a good old hand. Let's give Brother Michael, our pastor, a good old hand as he comes this morning. Can we do that? God bless you, Brother Michael.
Glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. I agree with Brother Johnson. I wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. Amen. Amen. Too far down the trail. Too close to making heaven our home. Somebody say, I thought I done made it there. He that endures to the end. If you endure to the end, you made it. Amen. That's what matters. Amen. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, God, we just come before you this morning thanking you for your love and mercy and kindness, Father. Lord, for the opportunity to be able to stand in front of such a great people, dear God. Lord, we just ask that you would come this morning, that you would quicken our hearts and open our minds, dear Heavenly Father, to the wonderful mind of Christ, dear Lord. For Lord, in ourselves, we are nothing and we have nothing, dear Heavenly Father. But Lord, if we can just dissipate this morning, Lord, and become nothing, Father, so that the Word of God can have free course, Lord. Lord, we'll be sure to give you all the praise and all the glory, Father. Supply each and every need. Heal, save, and deliver. Set the captive free, dear God. Lord, we'll give you all the praise and all the glory in the wonderful name of Jesus. We thank you. Amen and amen. And maybe seated this morning, if you will, talk about the Lord just a little bit. Amen. They don't have the screen on. I told them just don't worry about it. Sometimes we get here just a little bit late. And I mean, no, we need to be diligent about the things of the Lord. Amen. And we want to talk about the Lord just a little bit if we could. I ask you to pray for us. As I say so many times, I'm not a whole lot of anything. Maybe a whole lot of nothing. I don't know if you can say you're a whole lot of nothing, because nothing's nothing. I don't know how you get a whole lot of it, but anyhow, it's if it's possible, then that would probably be my description this morning. But one thing about it, we do love the Lord, and we ask the Lord to help us. I found out that through the years, there's nothing that I can do. I have not anything, but except for the Lord Jesus, and He is everything. Amen. And He knows everything. He has everything. He knows what you need. He knows what I need. And He looks into the depths of your heart this morning. And whatever your need is this morning, He can fulfill that need. We'll just let Him. I was thinking last evening, yesterday or this morning, I think it was last evening. But anyhow, just sitting there thinking, and I thought, Lord, you know, because I talking to Dwight yesterday, and he's training Joel a little bit on working on some of the CDs and things, and editing, and they was talking about the disc, and he said, well, you know, if we used MP3, we could get the whole service on there, you know, and we was talking about that, and talking about the other service the other evening, and I think it might have been last Sunday or whenever it was, and he said, yeah, he said, I had to really trim this one down. I had to take off some of the front of it, start where the scripture reading was to get it on the disc, I don't know why they make them this so small. It's only 74 minutes long. I mean, you know, should have a little more time than that. I guess maybe the preacher shouldn't preach like quite so long, huh? I was like, well, I thought I'd been trimming it down some and cutting back and, you know, and not going. I said, am I still going an hour? Yeah, it's pretty much the average, you know. And I don't mean to, you know, I don't want to weary you. I picked up a little booklet on ministering and preaching, and I told him that might have been a worthy investment. I don't know. I paid $2.50 for it, so we'll see how that works out. But he was talking about Stone. I think there was a preacher by the name of Stonewall or something like that years ago. And he was talking about this man heard him preach when he was just a child. He heard this man minister. And he said, you know, he could preach an hour and it seemed like 20 minutes. And of course, he was saying there's a contrast because there's some of them can preach 20 minutes. Yeah. And it seems like an hour. You know, so we don't want to bore you, you know. We don't want to just wear you out, and which you do keep coming back. So that's a good sign. Amen. You know, if the preacher comes and he keeps ministering and the people keep coming back, that could be a good sign. And so anyhow, but you know, when the Lord comes, he speaks and it's enlightening for all of us, ain't it? So many times he comes and reveals something, and that's what inspires me, because when he does, you know, and so many times there'll be things we've heard over and over and over again. And all of a sudden, the light comes on. And that brings inspiration, brings hope, it brings faith. Brother Jonathan was talking about experience. I told him the other day, Brother Jonathan, three Hebrew children, they had a confidence, they had a faith, they had a conviction. But after they come out of the furnace, they had an experience. Amen. And that's what we need this morning. We need experience with Jesus Christ. And I was thinking about that, and I thought, you know, what if we went to church, and every church service we went to, we come to church in the frame of mind that this could be the last one. And maybe advance that just a little bit. And let's come and come as this was the last one. Because as long as we got that if, you know, or it could be, we still have hope that there's another one. But what if we came to church as that this is the last service, this last church service we'll be able to attend with the saints of God? My, I tell you what, you know, sometimes we look forward to camp meeting and things, but you wouldn't have to worry about camp meeting. Every service would be camp meeting. Amen. It would be, and it is, but my, sometimes we just scratch a little bit at the top of the surface. And you know, we talk about Brother George sometimes. And we said, you know, I think Brother Kenny was saying, he asked him a question, you know, and sometimes you just expect maybe a simple answer, and all of a sudden Brother George is boom, and you're like, where in the world did he just go? You know, I mean, he just dropped into the deep, you know, and man, you're grabbing for the gear, you know, you're trying to get the air tanks on, you know, because man, where he's going, we're gonna have to have some help here. And I remember so many times Brother would ask him questions, and about an hour and a half later, he says, did that help any? Well, I guess. I don't know if I can comprehend all that or not. You know, we'll try to take it in. And, you know, as children, a lot of times we just want a simple yes and no or a simple explanation. And I know sometimes that's what I need. I just need it simplified so I can get a hold of it. But the Lord is good, ain't he? I want to begin this morning, if we could, in Luke chapter 12. Like I say, I've had a thought, but a lot of times I'll get a thought on things and I just have to ask the Lord to help me, because sometimes I don't fully comprehend it. I try to study it, try to look, search it out, but try to find all the pieces to that puzzle that I can, but it takes the Holy Spirit to come and put them together, because so many times I don't have a clue. You know, I say I don't have a clue. Maybe the clue, that's all I have, maybe is the clue, you know, but the Lord, he can put it together, can he not? Oh, he's so wonderful. He's so gracious. So, you know, what can you say? I really appreciate the brother's illustrations the other night concerning the lamb. And I enjoy hearing different ministers at times, especially from different backgrounds. Sometimes they bring in an angle, a point of view that you haven't thought of. And the main thing is it lines up with the Word. As long as it lines up with the Word, it's good, amen. It just gives you another perspective. It just line upon line, precept upon precept. So wonderful. And so we enjoy that. It's we come to grow, as Brother Pike used to say so many times, to grow in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. A lot of people want to grow in grace, but you know, having that understanding of God. Because that what put you on that firm foundation. When you got that understanding, then your faith can be unmovable. Amen. That's what we need. Unmovable, unshakable faith in the Word of God. Once we do that there, we get settled. Everything's going to be all right. Amen. I believe everything's going to be all right. I don't care about the world around us. It can fall apart. You know, when it's all said and done, it's all going to be all right. Everything that's in him, amen. Maybe we'll just begin at verse 1, and I don't know that we'll read the whole chapter. It's a fairly lengthy chapter. But I do want to read a few verses of Scripture here this morning. As I say, just pray in your heart and ask the Lord to come and speak to us. And if we do that, then he is faithful, amen. He is faithful to come and speak to our hearts. And I know some of you have been blessed already, but still we want the Word of God. It's one thing to come into His presence, but we need the Word. We need that seed of life moving in our hearts. Because without that, we're lost. That's right. Well, without that, we're lost. We can feel the presence of God all day long. But without that Word, without that seed of life, all you're doing is getting wet. I tell you what, if that Word ever penetrates, that Spirit comes in and it germinates that seed of life, I tell you what, Paul said, I'm persuaded that nothing can separate me from the love of God. That's what locks it in, amen? Amen. He said, grieve not the Holy Spirit, whereby you are sealed to the day of redemption. Amen. So it is wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Says here, beginning at verse 1, in the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trod one upon another, he began to say unto his disciples, first of all, beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be known. Therefore, whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light. And that which ye have spoken in the ear, in closets, shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. And I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which, after he hath killed, hath power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 farthings, and not one of them is forgotten before God? But even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. Also I say unto you, whosoever shall confess me before men, him shall the Son of Man also confess before the angels of God. But he that denieth me before men shall be denied before the angels of God. And whosoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven. And when they bring you unto the synagogues and unto the magistrates and powers, take ye no thought of how or what thing ye shall answer or what ye shall say. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in the same hour what ye ought to say. And one of the company said unto him, Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. He said unto him, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you? And he said unto them, Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consists not of the abundance of the things which he possesseth. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentiful. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, This will I do. I will pull down my barns and will build greater. There will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. I will say to my soul, Soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. And he said unto his disciples, Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life what ye shall eat, neither for the body what ye shall put on. Life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. And how much more are ye better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to his stature 1 cubit? If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not. They spin not. Yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God should so clothe the grass which is today in the field and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not ye what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of a doubtful mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give to you the kingdom. Sell that ye have, and give alms. Provide yourselves bags which wax not old, and treasures in the heavens that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Let your loins be girded about, and your lights burning. I'm gonna stop right there. Jesus talking to the disciples, talking to the multitude, and giving some instruction here. And we can see that he makes a difference in things, and he points out the worth of a child of God. You know, and he talks about the sparrows and the worth of the sparrows and the lilies and the grass and all these things, and how that God, if he's concerned about these things which come and go with seasons, then what about you and I? And he's trying to make a comparison here to see our self-worth, as we might say. We talked a little bit about, self-esteem maybe from God's perspective. But really it's self-worth in the eyes of God. He thought you was worth so much that he came and he clothed himself in a human body just like you and I, so he could feel your pain and suffering, went to the cross and took our sin. That is such a marvelous thing, because thinking about that, as the brother was illustrating that the other night, as to that lamb, when the person that brought that lamb would lay their hand there and his sin would pass to that lamb would take that sin. And that's what Jesus did, as he went and he forgave sin. Thy sins be forgiven thee. You know, go thy way and sin no more. You're healed. And told that woman, said, she come caught in adultery. And he said, neither do I condemn thee. You know, and he took that sin. He took that sin. Now, I've made the statement that Jesus became that thief. He became that robber. He became that prostitute. He became that whoremonger. He became, not that he partook of any of those things, but he became that because he became sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. And to see what God has done is just, it just thrills your heart, because you realize, as I say so many times, he didn't just pack it up and put it in a backpack, in a suitcase or somewhere, and take it over there and say, he became that. I mean, it's one thing for the priest to come out there and he made those sacrifices and things, but see, that priest didn't become your sin. That priest, he made that sacrifice. You brought that animal, that lamb, that dove, that their pigeon, whatever it may have been, for that sacrifice. And he took that, and he was just there to appease God and to put this here blood until Jesus Christ came, that supreme sacrifice. And we see that, but Jesus came, and he didn't just go make a sacrifice, but he became that lamb that was to be put on that altar. He was that lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. So we see that God has done such a marvelous thing. And if you just think about that for a little bit, you know, you can't help but be joyous and realize that God has done so much, you know, and so many times we thank him so little for what he has done. He's given us so much. But when I think of this, you know, as to, he says that even the sparrows, he says, consider the ravens, for they neither reap nor sow, which neither have storehouses or barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? Now, when he first started, he talked about if five or so for a farthing here, which I would assume is a very small amount, that and God has not forgotten one of them. He said, not even the very head, the hair of your head. He said he has got it numbered. Boy, some of us would be kind of glad about that. Amen. Brother Fontaine ain't lost a one. You might not see them, but they're all there waiting. Amen. When you see Brother Fontaine in that glorious body, that glorified body, you know, you might have to take a double take. Say, wait a minute, that ain't what I remember seeing. But what are you going to see? That, ain't that beautiful? You're going to see a young man full of health and strength standing there, head full of hair, and whoo, praising God, saying hallelujah like nobody else can. Amen? Ain't that wonderful? Another reason to make it, ain't it? Just to be able to see Brother Fontaine on the hills of glory hollering hallelujah. Amen? So it's glorious. But God makes a difference. He makes a difference between man and beast. He makes a difference between him and these little fowls, these little birds that God even takes notice of. But he says, how much more? How much more? And I believe that God made man an eternal creature. I believe that he set out to make him an eternal creature. And when I read over in Genesis, when God, he made man, it says that he made man and that he breathed the breath of life into him. He breathed the breath of life. There was a brother preaching about that. I wish I could remember some of the things he said there about that. It was very good, bringing that quickening of life. But he breathed the breath of life into him, and he became a living soul. I believe God, when he did that there, he made him an eternal being. So how could that be? Because how do you get part of God without being an eternal being? Now, don't you believe that breath of God, that there's Spirit of God, that he breathed into the nostrils of man, he became a living soul. There was something there that was to be eternal. He made man to be eternal. He made him to be God's. He made him to be God's. He didn't make man to die. God didn't make man to die. He made man to live. He had the breath of God. God breathed into his nostrils. And believe me, if God is life, and God breathed into the nostrils of man, you partaking of that breath of life, I believe that there is life eternal. So what happened? Well, there was a fall. There was something that happened that differentiated, that caused man to fall. And what did he do? He fell from that state as to the place that God had made him. He fell from being as to the in the image as to the Son of God, and he fell to the beast level. But there was a reason. There was a reason that happened, and it was because of unbelief. Satan came in and he questioned God. And that is the only way in the day that we're living in that Satan can get in is by getting you to question God. If he can get you to question God, then he has a place. He has a place. But I believe God, Jesus talking to the disciples here, he wanted to make a distinction. And that's why he told us, don't be concerned about these things as to worry, because he said, if I am so concerned about the little sparrow, then I am more concerned about you. And he said, you seek first the kingdom of God, and these things shall be added. They shall be added to you. That's his word. That's a promise. That's a promise. But I believe, thinking about this, we look, and the Bible says that God so loved the world that whosoever believes on him should not die, should not perish. Is that right? In John 3:16, he talks about that. And it also says that to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Now, I'm going to approach something from maybe a little different than maybe what you've heard or maybe what you've thought this morning. So bear with me just a little bit. And listen, because that's why I say I try to think about these things and I try to pray and say, God, you've got to come and you've got to bring the inspiration. You've got to quicken this because, you know, I don't want to come up here and just because it might sound good or maybe it sounds different, that doesn't make it right. See, I don't want to tell you just because it sounds different or it sounds good or maybe it makes me feel good, but I want to make sure that it is the Word. It's got to be in the Word. But then at the same time, just because we hear something that's a little different than what we've always heard doesn't make it wrong. And I believe you'll find out that it goes right along with everything we've heard. You hear what I'm saying? But sometimes if somebody don't say it exactly the way Brother Pike said it, or the way we've been used to hearing it, then for some reason we got a block that comes up saying, man, now wait a minute. Stay with the word. Stay with the word. Say, you're trying to go contrary. No, I'm not going contrary. I'm just trying, you know, don't let thoughts and everything go too far out of bounds here. Don't worry, it'll be in the word. We'll stay with the word. I'll close it and shut up and sit down before I go off the word if the Lord will help me. Yeah, I wouldn't intentionally do that. I ain't saying I can't. I'm saying I won't intentionally do that. That is one prayer I have. God, don't let me be deceived. Don't let me deceive others. Because you are susceptible. Satan is always trying to lead you off track. Minister, you're always trying to get him to go down a trail. He wants to. Amen. And boy, he knows scripture. Don't kid yourself. But what I'm thinking about, see, I'm thinking that this breath of life, that God has placed something on the inside of man. When he breathed it, I believe that God made a difference between man and beast. I believe he made a difference. And when he breathed in there, that breath of life, he made him a living soul. He made him an eternal being. He made him something that was to last forever. He put something there that would be with him throughout eternity. And it was Satan that came along, but God allowed that. Because I believe that God gave us a sovereignty. I believe that God gave us a right of choice. I believe because I don't think God wanted us to be zombies. He already had the angels. He already had those that was obligated to worship. But he wanted someone that could experience. He wanted an experience. He just didn't want a conviction. He didn't want just a faith, but he wanted an experience. And he wanted someone that he could communicate with, and he could communicate with them. And that's why he came and he robed himself in a human body so that he could feel our infirmity, so he could be on our level. Because after the fall, God didn't know pain. God didn't know suffering. God didn't know rejection. God didn't know those things. So he had to come into a human body and he had to get down on our level so he could feel the same pain. A high priest touched by the feeling of our infirmity. Ain't you glad for that? That he loved us so much that he was willing to put on a body that looked like this, looked like that. He said that he had no beauty that any should desire. A man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. I'm sure as a young man, only 33 years old, when he went to the cross, I'm sure he was a man that looked much older. I'm sure even his natural being, just walking the hills of Judea and traveling by foot and by donkey and things and pressing and praying and carrying the weight that he carried, it just done something. But look at our presidents. It's a great responsibility. You'll see them go in to office. Boy, and you can see their age just take off. You can see it in there by the time they leave office. I mean, they've aged. They've put some years. They did more than just them 4 years. It does something. But Jesus was carrying the weight of the world. He was carrying the weight of the world because he knew that hour was coming. That's why he went to the garden. He said, Lord, if it be thy will, oh, can this cup pass from me? But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. I'll do it. This is what I came for. But there was a part of him, there was a side of him that felt that rejection, that was feeling that their pain, that sorrow, knowing that the Holy Spirit, the Heavenly Father, was going to have to pull from him and turn his back on him because he was becoming black as sin, and God couldn't look on that. Oh, it just ripped his heart out. The Bible says that he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood. Tore him apart. But he loved us so much. He loved us so much. But I believe that God gave us a sovereignty. And I believe that there was something that he put on the inside. And I believe that That was a part there that had meant to be eternal. And I believe that that's why he said that to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. There was something, I believe that there was a seed placed there. I believe there was a seed placed there. There was something put on the inside, even from the beginning. And I know we talk about predestination, but he predestined according to foreknowledge, according to what he's seen, how he's seen you respond when that word of God came. But I believe there was something placed even when he breathed that breath of life into man. I believe there was something put there. That's why man wanders to and fro, longing for God, looking, and he's looking for love. We say in all the wrong place. He's trying to find the satisfaction. He can't find it in science. He can't find it in this. He can't relationships and everything else. He can't find it because that there that God has put there can only be fulfilled by God. It's like a big black hole, and there ain't nothing that's going to fill that void except God. That place was put there by God for God. Nothing else can take that place. But I believe that there is an awakening. I believe that there is an awakening that comes forth when we hear that word of God. And that, what did Satan do? See, he come to get them to disbelieve. Say, well, how is all this? Because, many times we'll hear and we'll hear it preached and we'll talk about the seed of the serpent. We'll hear about the seed of God. But see, where is it? What is it? Where does it come from? See, where does it come from? What did Satan do? Satan caused them to question. He caused them to doubt. Even Jesus right there in Luke, he's talking about this and talking about faith and what God has done. And what did it say right there? Oh, ye of little faith, he said, neither be, seek not what ye shall eat or drink, neither be ye of a doubtful mind. A doubtful mind. That doubtful mind, I believe, is the seed of the serpent. That is what Satan came in with, and he seduced Eve, and he caused a question mark to come there questioning God Almighty. And he brought that there. And then in Hebrews, if we can get to some of these scriptures, he's talking about in chapter 3. He says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ. He's addressing brethren, partakers of that heavenly calling. How do I know that? How did I know that I'm not a seed of the serpent? Man, how do I know that I'm not of Satan? Jesus looked at some of them and said, you have your father the devil. How do I know? Because I believe the word of God. It's by faith are you saved. It's by faith. And I believe that there's something there. God has got a seed down there, and there's something about it when he hears that word of God that faith arises in the heart, and that seed germinates and comes to life. Amen. I believe that is the difference. Other people hear that, and what does Paul say in verse 12? Take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. An evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. God made you for him. God made man for himself. It was that evil heart of unbelief that separated him. It ain't a matter of man coming back to God. It's a matter that man fell because of unbelief. God put something on the inside that had to do with faith that believed the word of God. That's what separates. That's why Jesus said, let whosoever will may come. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to whosoever believeth. That's why it was there to whosoever. That's why we preach the gospel, so that somebody can hear that word, so somebody can believe. Yeah.
Because God has put something there in man from the beginning. And he's seen from the beginning those that would believe. But he's seen those also that would have that evil heart of unbelief. See, he said, don't do as they did in the days of the provocation. When they come through the wilderness where they tried me, where they tested me, where they provoked me. Why? Because of the hardness of the heart and the unbelief. Jesus is trying to tell them, if you can just believe, all things are possible to them that believe. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Oh, and then Jesus is talking there to him. He said, and there's nothing hid that won't be revealed. Oh, I like to look at the other side of that. And he said that now he's bringing forth the manifold wisdom of God. Oh, eyes not seen, ears not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things that God has for them that love him. Oh, but to them that have his spirit, he has revealed them. There's nothing hid that he won't bring forth and reveal even in the mind of Christ. If we can just believe. Oh, let's don't have an evil heart of unbelief. That is that seed of the serpent. But you can do away with that seed of the serpent. You can do away with that old doubtful mind. And you can bring it into subjection to the mind of Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, and we can sit together in heavenly places. We can sit together and feast together in heavenly places. Oh, hallelujah. When we realize that. Oh, we don't have to go out here and try to discern and try to separate. All we got to do is look for that heart of belief. All we got to do is look to that their heart of righteousness. Because when you're looking to that belief, you're looking to faith in God. I tell you what, it will do something on the inside. There is a seed that God has put there, and we just let that Holy Spirit come, and it germinates. When that happens, then we start that process. We start the journey. And what is it? Let go and let God have his wonderful way. And we learn that that's all we got to do. Is just step aside. Just cease from our own works. Oh, we realize that when we have ceased from our own works, what have we done? We enter into that there rest of God. That's what he says in Hebrews 4. Let us therefore fear lest the promise being left us. Lest that promise being left us. See, we say, well, how can we lose this? By doubt. By unbelief. What did Peter do? He was walking on the water. But all of a sudden, he began to observe the surroundings. And just that quick, he went from a master to needing saved. Just that quick. He said, let us therefore fear lest the promise of being left us entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. It's got to be mixed with faith. It's got to be mixed with faith. So what are you saying? We all came from God? Absolutely. Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated. Both born of the same seed. Isaac and Ishmael of the same father. See, it came God. The Bible says that he creates the good and the evil. He has his way in both. It all came from God. And the only way we fall from grace is through unbelief. But if we can step out by faith, we can do like Peter did and we can walk on the water. Amen. And you think about that, because I think of what happened with the apostles, and they had great faith and they went out and they preached and they healed the sick and they cast out devils and they came back rejoicing. But Jesus said, don't rejoice over this. Rejoice that your name's written down in the Lamb's book of life. Why? He's saying you got a faith, you got a conviction, that's good. But you go over there to Jerusalem, you tarry till the Holy Spirit comes, that comforter I'm sending, because you're going to have an experience. Oh my, when they came out of there, Boy, they began to preach the word with boldness. I like that one place because it talks about the house shaking and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and they began to proclaim the gospel with all boldness. Preaching what? The resurrection of Jesus Christ. What? It ain't just something that we read in a storybook. It's not something we talk about because it happened 2,000 years ago, but it happened in my life and it happened in your life. That quickening of the Holy Ghost, that their resurrection power, it has moved, it's come alive today. It ain't just happened back there after Jesus rose 3 days after they crucified, but it happened today in 2012. This is the day of resurrection. Hallelujah. Children of faith, the seed of God, come alive. It's come alive. Oh, it's so wonderful. Oh, we don't want to have in us an evil heart of unbelief. No, we want to stand on the promises of God. Amen. It don't matter what the winds and the waves, it don't matter about the turbulence. It don't matter if the devil is tearing my nerves apart, if he's stringing it from one end to the other, every little one, it doesn't matter because I'm standing on the word of God and he said, I have been made whole. Satan, it don't matter if when I get through, if you throw me from limb to limb into little bitty pieces, when I get done, I shall see my Redeemer. Amen. Whew. That's bad enough to make you shout. Amen. People wondering what we get excited about. Oh, I tell you what. You just think about that great God Jehovah, the provider. Oh, to think that he's come and he's living my heart. Jesus said, and I'll make my abode in you and he in me. Oh, it won't be you doing the works anymore, but it'll be the Heavenly Father. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, for as we have believed, do enter into rest. When you believe, you get a rest. Amen. As he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. God got upset with some of them because of their evil heart of unbelief. They didn't believe the words. He brought them out of Egypt. He worked the miracles. They seen all the things, but the Holy Ghost had not yet been given, and they had an evil heart of unbelief, and they could not go into Canaan land. Oh, we think, my, if I could have just walked back there with Jesus. Oh, if I could have just heard the apostles. Oh, if I could have walked with Paul. Oh, if I could have walked with Brother Brown. Oh, my, if I could have been in them meetings. Oh, if I could have been back there with Brother Pike. Boy, if we could just rewind things just a little bit. Oh, we don't need to rewind nothing. What we need to do is unwind just a little bit. We just need to begin to walk in faith. We just need to begin to walk in the word that's been brought and let that word become manifest in our life. And that word shall become flesh. Amen. Oh, that there seed needs to germinate in our heart and in our life. Oh, I tell you, God placed it there in man when he breathed that breath of life in there. Oh, but he brought it to life, and he brought it to light when he came at Calvary. And there he brought that there spirit of life, and where because man had failed because of unbelief, but now he said because of faith you can become the sons of God. Now, beloved, are you the sons of God? Oh, my. God's eternal creatures, eternal beings to spend eternity with him. That's what we are. That's what he made us to be. We ain't God because we made ourselves God. We're God because he made us gods. We're just offsprings of our Heavenly Father. Boy, what else can you be? Amen. Seed of life. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise. And God did rest the seventh day from all his works. Oh, hallelujah. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Saying, therefore, it remaineth that some must enter therein. Some must enter therein. Oh, somebody's going to run that 4-minute mile. Oh, somebody's going to believe what Paul said when he said they shall not all sleep, but they shall be changed in the moment, in the quick twinkling of an eye. Somebody's going to enter in that rest of God. Somebody's going to believe it for what it said. Oh, somebody's going to yield. Somebody's going to surrender. Somebody's going to be poured out on that altar like a living sacrifice. Till there's nothing left. Oh, and they're going to stand, and it ain't just going to be Paul standing anymore saying it's not I that live, but it's going to be the church of the living God, because he said, I'm coming for a church that's not going to have spot, wrinkle, or blemish or any such thing. Why? Because she's going to stand in faith. She's going to stand on the word of God. She's going to be just like Mary was when she said, according to your word, so be it. Yeah. That church is going to stand upon the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Oh, I tell you what. What a glorious day. What a glorious hour. Oh, brothers and sisters, we're living in that time. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter in. And they that to whom it was first preached entered not because of unbelief. They didn't enter. They kept finding fault. They kept ridiculing. They kept questioning their mind. Oh, but there was some that was just like a little child. Oh, he said the kingdom of heaven is like to a little child. You shall no wise enter therein except you become as this little child. You take me at my word, you become innocent. Oh, and we find out that we're innocent through the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, we realize that that Lamb of God, it takes away the sin of the world. Oh, that there Lamb of God, that the Heavenly Father, you know, as he stood there and he took all those sin from those that have trespassed. Oh, and all of a sudden we believe it. So I believe it. I'm talking about 24/7. Point. When Satan comes around, it doesn't matter. Because he pounds on the house. Oh, you know, if you're a son of God, why ain't you doing this? Why ain't you doing that? Why did you do that? Why did you think that? Why did you do that? Why did you go over there? Why ain't you doing this? Why ain't you like this? Why ain't you like Brother George? Why ain't you like William Branham? Why ain't you like Jesus Christ? Says, Satan, I am. I am. I might not have that measure, but I'm pressing for that mark and that high calling in God, and they can't even be made perfect without me. Oh, I've got a calling this morning. You've got a calling. And yet we think that they had a calling in their life. Their calling can't even be made perfect until me and you step up to the plate. Oh, the thing that they preach, the life that they live, won't even be manifest until you and I. It's up to us. Oh, but some, cause of unbelief, they weren't counted worthy. See, there's that old seed of the serpent right there. That evil heart of unbelief. That evil heart. Oh, Cain, he came over there. He made a sacrifice, but it was in unbelief. It wasn't according to the word of God. Oh, he brought something. Oh, but it was, look at what I can do. It was of my own hands. Look what I have done. Oh, but somebody got a revelation. Oh, it said there was a lamb that was slain. Oh, who told Abel to sacrifice a lamb? Oh, what caught his attention? Oh, yeah, but he was a sheep herder. See, but what was it? It had that was something that had a breath of life. Oh, them fruits, what? They went back to the earth. That which goes back to the earth is earthy. That which is heavenly. Amen. Oh, there was a type and a shadow. See, it went back to the earth. It died. Oh, but there was a lamb that was spanked. And Jesus said, I come that you might have life and have it more abundant. Filled up and overflowing. Oh, what else can it be? He is the Father of life. The Father of light. The Father of life. It can't bring nothing else but life. Oh, but some of them, because of unbelief, he limited a certain day. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? Oh, there remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. There's a rest. Oh, it's rest in Jesus. I'm telling you, when you surrender your heart and your life to Christ, there's a rest. There's a peace. It's joy unspeakable. It's full of glory. There'll be something just settled down on the inside. Ain't you looking for that? Are you longing for that? Have you had it once in your life? I tell you what, if you will change from that unbelief to faith, you can have it again. You can have it again. It's up to us. There remaineth a rest. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works as God did it. Yes. God ceased from his own works. That's why the other night I was reading that. Jesus said, it's not I that do the works, it's the Father. It's the Father. Oh, it's a church that's going to respond to the very thoughts of God. Coming to that place. Oh, it might not look like it, but he's got a remnant. It might not look like, we look at the mass multitude, it may look like the church is further away from God than she's ever been. Oh, but I can tell you that there's a little Mary somewhere. Oh, there's a Mary somewhere. There's that there little virgin somewhere. There's that there little child of God somewhere that is keeping themselves for God. Oh, that's been set apart for the master's use. Oh, and she's not just going to be justified. Do you hear me? There was a message of justification. Oh, it was great. God picked them up and he brought them out of Egypt. Amen. Oh, and then there came that sanctification. And here came the sacrifices. But we're still in the wilderness. Amen. Oh, but there comes a point in time that when they be justified, oh, it has to be that way. Oh, it's got to come out. It's got to be given some worth. Oh, and then it's got to be cleansed. Oh, you ain't going to pick that there vase up and that nice goblet up out of the dirt and the mud and just pour some nice wine in there. Oh, no. You're going to take that thing and clean it up. Oh, you're going to clean it and you're going to polish more. You get it just right. Oh, but then there's some that's going on into Canaan. Oh, there's some that's fit for the master's use. He's going to begin to pour that wine in there. Oh, so he can serve the guest. Oh, you thought he just filled you up for yourself. Oh, no. He wanted to spread you around a little bit. He wanted to give somebody a drink. Amen. You're just a goblet in the master's hand. Oh, but there's some that moved into that rest. Oh, when we got over there with Joshua, he just began to command the sun and the moon. He began to move things into heavens. Went from that natural realm, that physical realm, we're moving into that spiritual realm. Moving into another realm, another world. See, ain't that the message that we've heard? A time of glorification. Age of glorification. All the other was necessary. You don't do away with that. It was necessary. Oh, but we've got to have this glorification. He's coming for a glorified church. Amen. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest. Lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. We don't want to be in unbelief. But I tell you what, we can have faith in our hearts. Those are the children of God. What makes the difference? Faith. Faith. And what did he tell them? Go your way and sin no more. Thy faith has saved thee. You're healed. Your faith has saved you. According to thy faith, so be it. Amen. What can you set your faith for this morning? See, we set our faith that, you know what? It's no longer my faith. But it's his. It's his.
Michael, come to me. The scripture where it says, as is now, so are we in this world.
Amen. That's right. As he is. I was looking at that the other day because I wanted to look that up again. Trying to make sure I read that right. I want to just quote something here. I want to make sure we read it, got that word. I would say that's powerful, that next verse. Word of God is quick. It's quick. It's powerful. It's vital. See, sometimes we might think there's something there that we just can't get over, we can't get past. If you'll put it in the hands of God, he said that word is sharper than a two-edged sword. Dividing asunder, even the marrow from the bone. You know what? He can cut out that old heart of unbelief. He can give you a heart transplant this morning. He can put a new heart in you. He said he'd take out that old heart of stone. That old heart of stone. Say, I'll do away with that first covenant and I'll bring you into a new one. I'll bring you into a new one. See, what was the law for? It's for the flesh. We don't, those that don't walk after the flesh, but walk after the spirit. Oh, it's so wonderful. God has done. I believe he put that there. Just a matter of quickening. Just a matter of quickening. Seed of faith. That's why Jesus said, now, beloved, you're the sons of God. To as many as believe, them gave you power. Can we stand together this morning? I trust maybe something's been said to encourage your heart. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Man, we're too far down the road. God has shown himself strong too many times. Amen. Just remember, when that them thoughts come to you, what to say about those thoughts of accusing or else excusing? It talks about building up your most holy faith. One way you can tell whether it's of God or if it's of the devil. What is the end result? The reason I say the end result, the devil will quote the scripture. See, that voice comes and the end result causes you to question the word of God. Causes you to have unbelief. Oh, well, you're a good fellow and all these things, but you're probably really not called for that. You're probably really not called for that. He probably come to Brother Fontaine a few days back, a few months ago. He said, well, Brother Fontaine, your days are numbered, boy. See, you're not called to overcome death. You're not called to overcome this sickness. I say, oh, devil, I tell you what, I might not be, but I happen to be bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. I know one that is, and I know one that has. Oh, it's not going to be your generation, it's somebody else's. God can use that one over there, you know, but, you know. Besides that, you know, you need to be humble. Don't think no more of yourself than you ought now. Come on. Oh, he's shrewd. Oh, he's sly as an old fox. When he gets done, does it question your sonship? Then you know that's that same old devil that was there at the beginning, the father of lies. And you can just look at him and say, Satan, there ain't going to be no heart, evil heart of unbelief in this body and this life. We're going to stand on the promises of God. His promises are yea and amen. He said he loves me, and that's all that matters. He loves me. Loves me so much, he died for me. What a glorious Savior. Amen. Can we sing a chorus together? The altars are open this morning. Oh, the light of the glory of his unveiled face, of his unveiled face, of his unveiled face. Oh, the light of the glory.
In Jesus' name.
sure that God made us eternal. Well, he said, speaking to him over there, he said that in heaven we're as the angels. Angels, eternal beings. I believe God's made us eternal. Yeah, you know, he didn't give us eternal life for us not to be eternal. That was the way he made man from the beginning. He meant for man to be eternal. But because of unbelief, man, thine iniquities have separated between thee and thy God. God made him upright. God made man upright. Oh, I tell you what, I'm glad that someone came and paid the price for our redemption. Amen. Glad he came and paid that price. Amen. I don't know. Mandy, how about y'all sisters come up here? Y'all just help us sing that song and we'll let you go. Let's just sing that song. Wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. I don't know who sings that or the kids. Tell them to come on. It don't matter. Tell the young people to come on and help sing too. It's all right. We just come to worship the Lord, didn't we? Amen. Don't forget the men's meeting tomorrow night. We do have a men's meeting, and don't forget that. Man, we want to do more for Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen. We'll turn it back to Brother Jim when they finish.
Jesus.
Ain't you glad for that journey this morning? Amen. I'm glad the Lord let us start out on that journey. The ladies sing, I've come too far to look back. Amen. Come too far to look back. Hope we'll all just take these things we've heard this morning. How many enjoyed this sermon? Amen. It's real good. I think we ought to give Brother Michael a good old hand this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's take these things this morning. And don't let them just go in one ear and out the other, but just let them find a place in our heart. Amen. And let them become one with us. We become one with them. Brother Winston, how about dismissing this morning? Would you do that?
Jesus, bow with our heads and our hearts. We thank you for your love. Amen. You've been with us. You've given us your word. You've given us your assurance. As dear children of God, and you've led us down this trail. And Jesus, reach out your nail-scarred hand and help those that always need your help. And Jesus, we'll be so careful to give you the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Praise the Lord. We're so glad that you have taken time to listen to this message by Pastor Beachy. We trust that you have been enlightened as well as inspired. For more messages on CD, DVD, and other resources, contact us at Post Office Box 129, Bogart, Georgia 30622, or visit us on the web at gracetempleonline.org. May God bless you.